All right, we're back at Panels Coffee Shop and Comic Book Store here in Oceanside, California. And we're with Scott Lost. How are you doing, Scott?
I'm very well. Thank you very much.
What are you working on here? I saw you drawing earlier.
So I'm working on a Planet of the Apes piece with a bad ape and Caesar. And it's fun to do. Something to keep me busy while we're here shilling our books to the public. So yeah, just something fun to do. I like to draw and talk and
Speaking
of, I'm trying to put it down while I'm talking to you. So,
speaking of shilling books, why don't you tell us about your book, Second Shift?
So we have a couple of books here. So the Second Shift is a story about minimum wage superheroes, people with normal 9-to-5s like you and I would have, as opposed to a Clark Kent or a Peter Parker who have amazing jobs. Not a large amount of the public can have jobs like that. So my characters have normal 9-to-5s. And then I also have the Accidental Aliens Anthology. This is a 2017 anthology, and we're going to have one for 2018 as well, but this is a series of short stories put on by my art group, the Accidental Aliens. So every year we're going to be having a new anthology out, and the Second Shift will actually fall under the Accidental Aliens banner, starting with issue 7.
Nice. Yeah, I enjoyed the Accidental Aliens. That was pretty cool.
Thank you.
I heard you talking earlier, and you mentioned that you used to be a wrestler.
Yes.
I found that pretty interesting. You want to tell us a little about that?
Yeah, so I was a pro wrestler on the independent scene for 10 years. Me and my writer, actually, we were both wrestlers. I actually co-founded Pro Wrestling Guerrilla. I was one of the original, this PWG6 is what they called us. So I was one of the founders for that, and I've wrestled in Southern California, on the East Coast, pretty much all around the world, Japan, Europe. So, that was fun. It was a good time.
So how did you find your way into comic books? I mean, were you always into comic books as a kid?
Yeah, definitely. I actually trained myself when I was a kid to draw comic books. It was what I wanted to do with my life, my entire life, except for my late teens. I started, wrestling was really popular in the late 90s. And but I had been watching it since I was a kid. And so I started training to be a pro wrestler, and then I wrestled for 10 years. So I put my comic book aspirations on hold. So, at the tail end of my wrestling career, I was getting back into comics and wanting to draw comics. And so it was an easy transition to get away from pro wrestling and to go back into comic books.
What was your signature move as a wrestler?
I had a bunch. I created a lot. I'm a creative person. I like creating things. So I used to create wrestling moves. But my finisher back in the day was a big fat kill, which was a spinning hook kick to the face. And so it's like a, you know, it's not quite the super kick, but it's a spinning hook kick. So that was, and another one was the Superman spear. That was something I was known for, which is I would basically jump and fly from the middle of the ring into the corner where my opponent was, like into their midsection.
Is there a YouTube video that we can watch?
Yeah. If you type in Scott Lost Pro Wrestling, a ton of stuff will pop up. There's fans have made tons of videos of me, so there's a lot.
I guess we can shift back to your comic book. I was trying to work it in there.
Yeah, it was there. You were almost there. You were there.
How did you come up with the idea for it?
So I created these characters when I was in seventh grade. So when I was younger, initially they weren't what they are now. So as the years have gone on, as I've grown and matured, so have they. They've changed. Like they're in their early 20s. So but when I originally created them, I would say they were around that same age. Now that I think about it, because I was a X-Men fan growing up, and so a lot of them were X-Men inspired initially, and then as the years went on, they just kept changing and becoming different things and different types of people and more well-rounded. So I've had them forever, and as like I said, as I've grown, they've grown. And the main character, his jobs usually fall on whatever my job was. The main character works at Fish World, which is my first job was SeaWorld. So that's him right there, and it's very reminiscent of the colors and the uniforms back then. So but I made sure to tweak the logo, make sure it's its own thing, and everyone has just different jobs, but he was one that more followed my my job paths, but they're all different parts of my personality. So where he's the leader, he's this guy, Eddie. He works at a comic book store. You don't make tons of money working at a comic book store, but he loves it. Sometimes he gets paid in comic books. Sarah is his older sister, so he's kind of my youth, and you know, and she's very strict because she's the older sister of Eddie. They're both Filipino. I'm Filipino, and Anne here is a college.
Mabuhay.
And Anne here is a college student, and she doesn't have a job. So that's kind of like she's my intellect. So they're just different parts of my personality, and it's makes for easy writing. So even though I have a writer, we talk a lot, and he knows exactly who they are as people. And anytime something's off, it's easy for me to identify because it's like, well, that part of my personality would never do something like that. But then there's parts of it that's like, okay, like we have to kind of steer away from that a little bit to make them more individual and you know, seem like one person. Yeah.
It seems like a lot of creators that I've been talking to recently, they talk about their collaborations with, you know, other people and how they found like their creative team.
Yeah.
How did you find like your collaborators?
Oh, my writer is a wrestler. So yeah, so we liked a lot of the same things. We would see each other at shows all the time, and we'd talk about comics, Bruce Lee, shoes, basketball, and so we had all this stuff in common, and he would always send me scripts of his comics. He was like, hey, I want you to read this. And he always wanted me to draw his books, and a lot of his stuff revolved around war and stuff like that, and that's not really my jam. So I was just like, hey man, why don't you try writing my story? And so I gave him like kind of a scene. I gave him character traits of everybody, their personalities, what things that they aspire to be, you know, what I see them being in the future. And I was like, put him in a restaurant and write that scene. Let me hear that conversation, what that sounds like. And it was great to get that back and read a conversation from characters that have been in my head for years, and just to read a story that I didn't make up. It's like, wow, that's them. That's who they are. And so just to have that initial shock of like, whoa, what? Like this exists, and it just felt good to read something I'd never thought of myself.
So what's next for you? What else do you have in the works?
The second shift is ongoing. It's ongoing series. I will probably draw that until the day I die or my hands don't work anymore. But beyond that, I'm actually finishing up the seventh issue of the second shift. I just need to lightbox and ink the last page and draw the cover. And then it's completely done. And then, well, the my part of it is done. And then I'll be having it color flat and colored. And then hopefully it'll be out by December. And then while all this is going on, I'll be working back on The Wanderers of Melisandre, which is the anthology story that I do. So I started the first part in the 2017 anthology, and in 2018 will be the next installment.
Going forward, like, where do you see the, I guess, the space of like independent creators going?
You know, I think as time has gone by, independent creating has just increased more and more. So where I think a lot of people think that, you know, comic books and stuff like that were going to die, I feel like the independent creator is, you know, very much alive. Like, there's so many of us. I mean, a lot of us didn't even know each other. Like, we didn't necessarily know each other. Like, I just met Chad, I think, a month ago, and then so now we're doing another event together, and it's pretty cool that you know, just local creators and creators all around, they could put out their own books, their own stories, and have it exist without having to go through a big company to get it out.
Do you have any pieces of advice that you can give to somebody who's thinking about starting their own project?
Get it done. I know so many people that talk about making comics but don't make comics. Oh, I really want to do that. Oh, I'm going to get started. Or, you know, it's always about them wanting to do it but never actually doing it. So at the end of the day, you have to sit there and you have to put in the work. We're actually all talking about putting in the work in these books, how much time and effort it is. You know, it is drawing and it is fun. And I do love doing it, but at the end of the day, it's still work. Like, I think each page of my comic roughly takes me, well, lately it's been like 8 to 14 hours. So it could be a long period of time. And most of us as independent creators have jobs. So like my character is the second shift. The drawing comics is my second shift. I have two full-time jobs. I have my normal 9-to-5 job, and I have the second shift. And in all honesty, I probably put more time into the second shift than I do my day job. So, yeah. So yeah, put in the work. Put in the work. That's my number one to you guys as you know, inspiring creators. You need to put in the work. You need to be willing to sacrifice your time. You know, just to have the idea of it isn't enough. You actually need to, you know, not go out that night and not hang out with your friends certain nights. You can always make time for it, but at the same time, there needs to be blocks of time where you're actually putting in the work on the book.
I think there's a person by the name of Gary Vaynerchuk. I don't know if you're familiar with Gary. He has a saying that he says, eat crap for like a year and eat caviar for the rest of your life or something like that. So,
all right. That's interesting. I guess that's something along the lines like teach a man to fish, right? I guess that's the same concept, as opposed to you giving someone something and then instant gratification. You teach them how to do it, and then they can do it for the rest of their lives. I don't know, maybe something like that.
Yeah, it definitely has to deal with putting in the work, and like you said, you know, deciding not to go out at night, you know, clubbing, but actually honing your craft and putting in the work to get better.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you definitely, the struggle is real initially, and then, you know, the hope is it will pay off. You know, doing independent creating, like maybe it'll get picked up by a company that allows you to retain your rights and work on that full time, so you're no longer, you know, eating the crap, as that guy said. So
what do you do for fun when you're not working on second shift?
Ooh, that's a good, I play basketball, not well, well enough, but that's what I do. I love basketball, and I love comics, and those are my things. That's what takes up all my time. So even when I'm not working on my book necessarily, I am drawing. Like, I love drawing. Like, I'm working on Planet of the Apes right now just because it's something to do. It's fun. So yeah, drawing, as much as it is work, it's a blast for me. I love every minute of it.
So what are the comic books that you're reading?
Right now, I am reading Invincible. I just finished volume. Was it the latest hardcover, the latest Ultimate Edition? That's the one I just finished. I can't remember. I think it's 13, maybe 13. So I love Ryan Otley's work. The way he destroys people's faces is amazing. like just the way he breaks pages down as well. His storytelling is really strong, and I love it. I'm trying to think else. What else? Saga, of course. Saga is a constant. East of West and Black Science. I read a lot of Rick Remender. I love Rick Remender. He's probably my, like, between him and Robert Kirkman, those are my two favorite writers, just for different types of stories.
I think Black Science is something that I have, but I haven't had a chance to read yet.
Oh yeah, get into Black Science and Deadly Class. Deadly Class is fantastic. There's a part where you feel like, I don't know where this is going, because it gets like, there's like a little lull, and then out of nowhere it gets insane. You're like, oh my god, like this book's so good. So yeah, if you have a chance, check out Deadly Class and Black Science. Those are real strong.
Thanks for sharing those comic books. Where can people find you online?
You can go to accidentalaliens.com. You will find, well, right now we're under construction, but soon we will have our shop up, so you can pick up the Accidental Alien books, as well as the second shift. And the other book is Unstoppable Cherub by Travis Rivas. So he has issue one. This is issue zero, which I did the cover for. It is a flip book for issue six of the second shift. So check out that site, accidentalaliens.com, and you can pick up all of the Accidental Alien books there.
Cool. Well, thanks for your time, Scott. It was good hanging out with you again.
Yes, of course.
And I guess once you have any future projects, just let us know, and we'll get you on the podcast.
Absolutely, and I'll see you guys.